Good morning. Good morning. We are so thankful you are here today and that we get to worship together, that we get to have Pathfinders help us enter into worship and to teach us about God. But before we go any further, we have a public health announcement that we want to ask Dr. Peterson, one of our resident doctors, to come up and share with us. There have been a lot of questions about coronavirus and different things like that, and so we decided to give some information.
Good morning, church members. Is this on? Is it on now? Anyway, here at the church this last week, the administrative council met, and that included elders and all the pastors, and wouldn't you agree with me that if it's in the Bible, you can trust it? Our recommendations are right out of the Bible. But after we decided to delay and not do potlucks for the foreseeable future, delay the impact until later this summer, the phone calls started coming in, particularly about potluck and no handshaking. And I was accused of being of little faith. I didn't take well to that. I believe that what we've done here is prudent. We're not presumptive, but we're trying to be prudent with you. In your bulletin, I want you to pull out an insert that we have. And I'm going to try to make you Orthodox Adventists today. I want you to commit this insert to memory, and just in case you have a faulty memory, roll it up like a phylactery and attach it to your wrist, your pocketbook, or something so that you won't forget it. Because it tells you what you can do. You can cover your cough or a sneeze so that you don't infect others. You can wash your hands with soap and water. That is the best thing. Second best is use a sanitizer that has at least 60% alcohol in it. A little bit less than that, because these don't have 60%, are the hand wipes that are in many diaper bags. Should you use a mask? Well, there's been a run on masks. These masks are for people that are sick and those who care for them. The general public just wastes their money and makes the supply less. Avoid close contact with sick people. Close is 6 feet. Now, where do we pick up these things? On hard surfaces where somebody has sneezed on them. How long does it last on a hard surface? Probably not more than a few hours, but our experience with these viruses have shown that sometimes they last up to 6 days. So you want to cleanse them with things like this. If you look at the back of your Lysol or your Clorox dispenser, it says coronavirus covered. How can it say that? This is a brand new virus. In fact, it's so new, they use the French word novel. What does that mean? It means that nobody knows anything about it. It means they don't know of any antivirals and they don't have any vaccines for it. Have you learned what the word panic means? The world financial markets went into a panic. Here in Portland, if you went to Costco, Winco, Walmart, Target, you would find that they sold out of toilet paper, sanitizers. They're trying to get some in, but they've become a big shortage because of panic. And it's ridiculous, but that's what has happened. And what do we know about the coronavirus? Well, the coronavirus has been around, knowledge of it, since the 1950s. It's an animal virus. In the 1970s, they identified some strains that mutated and got into humans. So far, this is the 8th coronavirus that has mutated and infected humans. Five of the ones that we know about, you already know. It's called the common cold. Two of them you have heard about, but they didn't affect the United States. Do you remember the bird flu SARS back in 2003? That was a coronavirus, but it hasn't been seen now since 2004. In 2012, we had the MERS. That was a camel virus in the Arabian Peninsula. They had a lot of trouble. They were all making pilgrimages to Mecca, and they had a lot of camels. Fortunately, we only have two camels outside of zoos in the Northwest. So only two MERS cases came. Well, the situation was the SARS flu had a 10% death rate, but there was only 8,000 cases. In the MERS, there were about 2,500 cases and 850 deaths for a 34% death rate. So they were deadly. So far, with the COVID-19, we've had close to 100,000 people have it, and 3,000 plus have died from it. So it's about a 3% death rate. Guess what? That's about the same death rate we have from the ordinary flu. Still significant, still something you want to be prevented from. So it's close contact, droplet, it's a respiratory illness. What kills people? An adult respiratory distress syndrome where they drowned in their own secretions. And we have it in little babies, respiratory distress syndrome. Now, fortunately, nobody under 14 has died from this, but currently, we have a bigger problem with the ordinary flu. So, what are the symptoms? Same as the flu, fever, cough. If you get difficulty breathing, call your doctor. Don't just run into the emergency room because we're identifying special places for infected people to go. Who is at risk? Traditionally, we've said the very young, the newborns, haven't breastfed enough to have immunity, and the very old, defined as over 80. They have more comorbidities, but we really need to refine it. It's the immune suppressed, which would include a pregnant woman, which would include somebody on treatment for cancer, particularly those that have COPD. What have the Chinese told us? They've had the worst problem. Heavy tobacco smoking has been a risk factor, and that's why they're seeing deaths in the 30 and 40 and 50 and 60-year-olds, because they're heavy smokers there. Smoking causes COPD. So, is it faith or presumption? The Bible says, pray, trust the Lord, but be prudent. If you want interesting reading, go back to Moses, the father of public health, and read Leviticus, particularly Leviticus 11 and on into Deuteronomy. You'll find wash, 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 and go outside of the camp if you're ill. Please make your own phylacteries out of this little insert so you carry it with you and take care of yourself and others. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So you're saying we don't need to stockpile toilet paper then, huh? All right, I'll keep that in mind. But we do need to wash our hands. My mother-in-law likes to say that too, Arnold. I don't know. But anyway, just want to draw your attention to a couple things. We do have a lot of things going on next weekend. The Methuselah Factor presentations will be going on. For those who are interested in that, the information's in the bulletin. We also have a family skate night that's coming up. And you're welcome to come and bring your rollerblades if you have them, or if you have your own skates that you prefer to use, you can bring that as well. But just come on out with your family and let's have a good time outside of the confines of this building. We also have a couple people who have recently joined our church, and we want to acknowledge them. We want to draw attention to them. I know Eugene Lambert was transferring in. If he could just stand, if you could stand so that they have some flowers for you. Oh, he's in the back there. Also, I see Linda's up here. We had promised Linda we would give her some flowers, and so she's up here in the front. So we want to make sure she gets those. and I heard that Katya did walk in. She's in the back over there. And so we want to make sure she gets them. Evie, did you see Katya in the back over there? Yeah, okay, there you go. Thank you so much. If you want to just welcome them, just you can clap or you can wave and you can do whatever you want to do. Just welcome them into our family. Also, we want to make you aware of something else that's happening to some of our family members here at Sunnyside. The Westermeyers have recently experienced some loss. Ann lost her sister recently, and Rick lost his mother this past week. And so we just want to pray for them, ask you to pray for them as they're dealing and grieving with those two losses. Why don't we just have a word of prayer right now and lift them up in all of the program. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you. The Bible tells us that you are good. You are loving and you are caring. And we thank you for that. And Lord, in a very special way, we want to ask that love and that care that you can bring to us through your Spirit will be with the Westermeyer family at this point in time. It is difficult enough to lose one loved one, and when those things are compounded and we lose several at once, it's even more devastating. So we pray that you would be with the Westermeyer family in a special way, draw close to Rick and Ann, and just continue to help them to feel your presence. Also, Lord, we want to ask that you would continue to be with each and every person that is here. In a special way, we ask for our Pathfinders. As they lead us in worship, as they share through music, and as they share through skits and different things, we pray that your Holy Spirit would speak to our hearts, that we would hear the message that you want to bring to us through them. Help their nerves, calm their emotions, help them to remember their lines and remember the things they've practiced so that it will all be for your honor and for your glory. Lord, help us to remember that you love us and that you are always with us. Continue to be with us throughout everything that occurs in this place. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. You serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow.
How is everybody? Hope you're doing good. For our first song for today, we're going to be singing How Great Thou Art with a more contemporary song called How Great Is Our God. And I hope that you guys just listen to the words and sing.
Thank you guys so much for singing with us. You sounded so good. So for our next song, we will be singing Amazing Grace with a little bit of a twist. It's an added chorus. The words will be up on the sing, so please feel free to sing along with us. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for bringing each and every one of these people that are here to this room. Lord, I ask that you just please put your spirit on everyone, just touch their hearts in a mighty and powerful way. Lord, help them not to see the people that are upstage and not to see whatever faults we may have, but to see Jesus and his love and his grace shining through us. Lord, we love you so much and we thank you. In your name I pray, amen.
Amen. As I was thinking about this song, I was reading the chorus, and it says that God leaves the 99, which is referring to Luke 15, where it says, verse 4, suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Don't you leave the 99 in the open country and go after it? the one lost sheep until you find it. And when you find it, you joyfully put it on your shoulders and go home. Then you call your friends and your neighbors together and say, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost sheep." I tell you, in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one lost sinner than 99 righteous people who repent. And just then it hit me that every one of us is that one that's lost. And when I think about it, it just boggles my mind. Perhaps maybe you have not lived the life that you should have. Possibly you don't think you're doing a good job at raising your kid. Or maybe you can't seem to do well at your job. Or maybe everyone thinks you're dumb at school because you can't remember what you studied. And just think about how sad you would feel. And when you see Jesus, all you can see is love and compassion in him. And when you finally come to him, calling for his forgiveness, he welcomes you home and throws a big party for you. And the Bible also says that if it was just you on this planet, just you, the only sinner in the universe, that Jesus still would have come and died for you. That's how reckless God's love really is. As we sing our final song, I just want you to listen to what we're saying and how God's love is so much bigger and better than you ever thought it was.
Please stand.
1, 2, 3. So Heavenly Father, thank you for your reckless love. Thank you that you never fail us and that you will always be here for us. Thank you that even when we fail, you will never fail us and that your love is always here. We thank you and you claim that promise. Amen. You may be seated.
Happy Sabbath. Our Bible verse today comes from 1 Peter 4:8, and it says, "Most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other, for love covers a multitude of sins."
Good morning, church. Today, please bow with me for a prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this day, Lord. We come to you in prayer asking for stuff that hurts us, that makes us feel like we can't do something. Lord, thank you for everything you have done for every single one of us in this room. Please keep us safe. Just like Mom said, that one lost sheep, you go and find it. Lord, please help anybody that's not in church that needs to be. Please keep us safe. Please put your Holy Spirit on us. In your name, amen.
Thank you.
Good morning, boys and girls. Now it's time for children's story. Please collect the white buckets on the side of the pews and bring them up to the front for children's story.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. Today, we are going to do an object. Oh, my name's Grace.
And my name's Rachel.
And we're going to do an object lesson today. An object lesson is a lesson we're going to teach you today by using different objects. Now, can I have a volunteer to help me?
No volunteers.
What's your name?
Evelyn.
Evelyn. Cool. So this bowl is going to be someone else. So that can be your family, friends, or even the person you sit next to at church. And the sponge is going to be your heart. So can you squeeze as much love as you can out of your heart? Do you think that's enough? Okay, thank you. The water in the bowl represents when we try to show love to others. So do you think it's enough love to share with this whole church?
No. Can I have a volunteer, please? Okay, now I'm gonna need you to take the sponge and squeeze all the water you can into this bowl.
There's no water.
Squeeze all the leftover water you can. Oops, nothing left. Thank you. When we try to love other people out of our own abilities, it never really works. We aren't truly capable of loving others as well. How much water do you think you will be able to get into the second glass? He has none. There's nothing left. But can you try? Can you dip your sponge in and dip it into God's love? Dip it in and squeeze the water? Dip it in and then. Okay. Like, dip. Where is it? Yeah. Dip until it's full. You're taking like in like away then it does fall.
That's gonna be me.
Head up in. Keep it all the way in and then bring it out.
I'm trying. Okay, that's enough. Debbie says go on. Debbie says to go on.
Okay. Thank you. When Adam dipped into God's love, he was able to give a lot more love to others than we can by ourselves.
Okay, look at the difference between these two glasses. When we love people with our love, it's not enough to share with everyone. But when we love other people with using God's love, it's enough to share with this whole world. And thank you, and we have a little gift for you. Aw.
And girls, thank you for sharing the message of God's love. You know, when we're connected consistently to the source of love, things can go pretty well, can't they? You know, one thing that impresses me when I think about the story of the world and the story of love, of course, the scriptures say that God is love. And throughout the Old Testament, he was doing his best to convince humanity of that fact. But there were some ways in which we didn't actually get it until the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. It's as if even the all-powerful God, the God of the universe, needed human flesh to be able to show us what love looks like. And Jesus went away, he went back to heaven, but I'm not sure it has changed that much. When God pours out his love on the world, he pours it out through humanity. It's through things like touching each other or embracing each other, except today. Don't do it today. Today, it's like words of appreciation, words of care. It's about time well spent with people you care about. It's these ways in which we're able to be the conduits of God's love. Now, as Pathfinders, there's one thing that we talk about consistently, and that is we know that our church loves us. We know profoundly that our church loves us, and we see it played out in ways like this church helping us get to Oshkosh last August. The church expressed love in profound ways to help us get there. By praying for us, by creating opportunities for all of the activities you saw on screen as we get to spend time with these kids and mentoring them and caring for them and helping them grow and learn and all those things. All of that is possible because this church loves its Pathfinders, and we thank you for that. And so we were thinking, you know, how can we show love back? And if there are deacons at the back, now's the time for you to move. The deacons are going to pass a little tray along, and in that tray is going to be a whole stack of little wooden hearts. You just need one. Take a wooden heart, pass the tray along, and everybody should have a wooden heart. Because here's one of the things that I've learned over the years is that there are lots of ways to love people. One of the most profound ways to love them is to let them know you're praying for them. And as we've been thinking about how can we love our church, our community better, here's what we came up with. Here's what we hope you will do. We hope you'll take one of these wooden hearts. And we hope that you will write on it, maybe with your own pen so you don't share germs. Or if not, if you don't have your own pen, then grab the pencil out of the pew. and just write something that is on your heart that you're praying for. On the other side, if you want to sign your name, you're welcome to do so. We would love to know who we're praying with. But just write briefly what you're praying for. What we are going to do with these is at the end of the service, you will be able to drop it in a jar like this. There will be Pathfinders there ready to collect. And then each week, we're going to take the requests from this jar, and we're going to be praying with you as you're praying for whatever is on your heart. You know, a community that prays together stays together. And a community that prays for each other shows love to each other. This Sabbath, we want you to know that we love you. And the way we hope to be able to show you is by being able to pray for the request that you put in this jar at the end of the service. Thank you so much for being such an incredible, loving family of God.
Worried about that math test we took yesterday.
Why would you worry, Faith? You're a genius.
Yeah, but what if I get a low grade? I don't want to miss out on soccer just because I got a bad grade.
That's not gonna happen. You're the best word we've got. No teachers is gonna fail you.
Okay, but I still can't stop thinking about it.
You're going to be fine. You don't need to worry.
Thanks. I was really worried about this math test. Thanks, but I'm not so sure I'd be good at that kind of thing.
Okay,
I will. So, I've been practicing extra hard at home.
That's what I like to hear. You're a hard worker.
Thanks.
That's what I did last week.
Have you been thinking about playing soccer in college?
I don't know. Do you think I'm good enough?
I think you're more than good enough. I got a call from a recruiter today. Can I tell them that you're interested?
I don't know. Thinking about college is kind of scary.
That's okay. You'll do great in college. You'll be Division I player before you know it.
Thanks.
I'll see you at the game.
See you there. Everyone says I'm really great. They say I'm a genius, the best forward on our soccer team, the shining star of math class, smart, patient, helpful, maybe even a future Division I soccer player. I mean, even my parents have given me labels, like smart, kind, loved, and funny. My grandparents say I'm their pride and joy. And I mean, my brother says I'm pretty much okay, I guess. But I know differently. I'm a worrier. I worry about things all the time. The reason I'm so good at sports and school and math and everything else is because I worry about it. So I spend hours doing extra math problems and extra soccer drills because I'm not sure about where I'll be if I don't do those things. The thing is, I'm just not sure about the future. In fact, I'm kind of scared of it. My math teacher wants me to follow in his footsteps, and my coach wants me to play soccer in college. My family just wants me to be happy, but what can the future hold for someone like me? All of those labels, they just cover up what's hidden underneath. This one isn't a label. It's a fact. I'm a sinner, so I try to hide it. I try to cover it up with school and sports and everything else. But I know it's still there. I can't stop sinning. I can't be perfect. I've gotten labels from all kinds of people, friends, family, teachers, coaches. But the only thing I've gotten from God is sinner, and that's the most important one of all. So if sinner is all he can say, then that's all I really am.
Are you okay?
Oh, you're back.
Yeah, of course I am. We're going to the game, remember?
Oh, right, of course.
But we don't need to go yet. Are you all right?
Yeah, I'm perfectly wonderfully fine.
What are you doing?
I don't want you to see who I am.
What do you mean?
You wouldn't want to be my friend if you knew who I was, really was.
I don't get it. I know what you're like.
No, not really. I'm always trying to be perfect, but I'm not. I'm not perfect.
Well, of course you're not. Don't get me wrong, you're pretty great, but none of us are going to be perfect.
But I'm worse. I'm worse than everyone else.
No, you're not. You're not perfect. Of course you're not perfect, but none of us are perfect. It says you're a sinner, right?
Exactly. You too?
Yeah.
And it doesn't bother you?
Sometimes it does.
So what do? Do you try to hide it? Do you try to cover it up with school and sports and math? And
no, I don't do anything because Jesus has already taken care of it.
What on earth do you mean? God says I'm a sinner. That's it. End of story. I'm hopeless. I'm worthless.
No, you're not, Faith. Your true hope and worth aren't found in math or soccer, or even your friends and family. Your true hope and worth are found in Jesus Christ.
But I'm a sinner.
Yes, Jesus knows that, and he still loves you. Jesus knows that you worry. Jesus knows that you're not too sure about your future. Jesus knows that you're scared because of your sins. But he still loves us. That's why he died on the cross for us. That's what gives us hope. That's what gives us worth. And we may be sinners, but when Jesus looks at us, that's not what he sees.
Then what does he see?
He sees Jesus.
He sees Jesus?
That's right. He sees Jesus' blood covers us. It can be hard for us to see, but God always sees it when he looks at us. He doesn't see our sins. He sees his perfect son who sacrificed himself for us. We're covered, Faith. We don't need to do anything. Jesus already did it all.
I'm a sinner, but God still loves me?
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure about that?
There's no doubt in my mind. You see, we look at ourselves and we see all the labels people have put on us. We see that we're sinners, and we can't stop being sinners. But our true hope and worth aren't found. Our true hope and worth are found in Christ.
But what if I'm still not sure? What if I'm still scared? What if I still worry about everything all of the time?
That's not going to go away until Jesus comes back. But can I tell you what I like to do?
I mean, sure, I guess.
So I used to find myself putting negative labels on. I used to write things like stupid, always wrong, and always alone. But that's not what Jesus sees. That's not who he made us to be. So I started writing different kinds of labels and putting them on when I started feeling the weight of my sins. Here, I think you need these more than I do today.
Thanks.
See you at the game tonight.
See you. Thanks, Azzy.
Mm-hmm.
Loved. Saved. Chosen. Child of God. And never alone. I'm a sinner. That's a fact. And there's nothing I can do to change that. But I'm also a child of God, loved, saved, chosen, and never alone. And those are all facts, too. My sins are covered by the blood of Jesus. I don't have to work harder. I don't have to be perfect, because Jesus was perfect. And that's all that really matters. My hope and worth are found in Christ alone.
For our closing hymn this morning, we're going to be singing How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And I would ask that you to please stand as we sing.
Father in heaven, how deep your love for us. We thank you for that deep love that looks beyond what the world might see, that looks beyond the labels that have been placed on us. Some well-meaning, some not so well-meaning. Lord, we thank you that you look down at our hearts. And we thank you that even though we were sinners, you loved us and you sent your Son to die for us. Father, in this place today, we have all come in maybe carrying burdens because of labels. Maybe burdens that we've carried for years because since we were little, we've had labels. Maybe labels that the enemy has placed on us. But Father, here today, I ask that you would help us to remember that those labels ultimately are meaningless. Help them to melt away into nothingness and help us to remember that the most important thing is that we truly are loved. We truly are saved. We truly are chosen. We truly are children of God. Thank you so much for loving us in spite of our sinfulness and for redeeming us through the blood of the Lamb. It is in His name that we ask these things, that we give you thanks. Amen.